بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise and thanks belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may the peace and blessing of Allah be upon His servant and final messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As to what follows, my dear respected brothers in Islam, we still continue our series of what do we learn from Ramadan? What are the lessons that we learn from Ramadan? We've reached about the seventh lesson. And today what we want to share is, in Ramadan, of course, a person prays more than he prays other than Ramadan. For in Ramadan, a person gets to learn the importance of Salat and what change it's supposed to create in his life, and what is Salat meant for anyway from the very beginning. For this is something that we learn in Ramadan, and we come face to face with Ramadan. People are more concerned in their Salat, praying their prayers on time in Al-Masjid. Then on top of this, praying the night prayers, Qiyamul Layl in the last 10 nights, Salat al-Taraweeh as well. Maybe if someone missed them in the Masjid, he'll make up for them at home. When there is importance given to Salat during the blessed month of Ramadan. Now we need to understand the Salat, what kind of feeling is supposed to be experienced by a person when he is praying. And obviously this feeling will only come through Al-Khushu', which is the greatest pillar of a Salat, Al-Khushu'. فنحن, we want to just check something few, little bit of hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and what is basically a practical solution in how one can begin to change his Salat for that which is better, change his Salat for that which is appropriate, change his Salat for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from a person when he prays. Salat, my brothers in Islam, لما النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم undertook the journey of الإسراء والمعراج. Do you know الإسراء is the journey from مكة to بيت المقدس to Jerusalem. That's الإسراء part. والمعراج is from بيت المقدس up to the sky, to the heavens. This is المعراج. During the night of الإسراء, this journey, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, he saw a lot of things when he was on البراق. This lightning, this lightning speed of a creature that he was on, he saw many things. One of the things that he saw as he got close to Bayt al-Maqdis, and the journey was at night. سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِي لَيْلًا مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. Well, Isra is a word used to describe a night journey. So he was traveling at night. As he got close to Bayt al-Maqdis, he said, فَرَأَيْتُ مُوسَى قَائِمًا يُصَلِّي فِي قَبْرِهِ. He saw Musa alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam, we know where he's buried. He's buried عند الكثيب الأحمر, where the red sand dunes are, right before Bayt al-Maqdis. This is very clear for the one who drives past it to see it. But they're huge, they're acres and acres of this red sand dunes. And Musa alayhi salam is buried somewhere there. Exactly where, Allahu alam, but he's buried somewhere there. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he passed by his grave, and he said, I saw Musa qa'iman yusalli fi qabri. He was standing praying in his grave. Subhanallah, it's most certain and most definite that the grave of Musa alayhi salam is rawdatun min riyad al-jannah. It is one of the gardens of the gardens of the paradise. Musa alayhi salam has left this paradise that's in his grave, and he's standing, he's praying. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw him in that state, what kind of experience, what kind of taste and what kind of sweetness and what kind of connection did Musa alayhi salam have with the Salat to leave Na'imul Qabr, to leave these blessings and these gardens of paradise within the grave to stand and pray before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-ulama rahimahumullah, they say that there are certain people that begin to experience this intense connection with the Salat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not deprive them from a Salat even in their grave. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he mentions this. He says there are people that get connected with certain and specific types of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not deprive them from that worship even in their grave. And what connection have you had, and with what kind of worship have you had a connection with? So that Allah Azza wa Jal does not deprive you from it even when you're in your grave. These people, Musa alayhi salam and the likes from Ibadillahi al-Saliheen, their prayer wasn't just an image. Their prayer was a reality of what Salat is supposed to be. Their Salat, their dua, everything they did for Allah Azza wa Jal's sake was a reality of what it's supposed to be, not just an image. Anyone can bring an image about. Innama, what counts before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the reality of a worship that a person dedicates his life for. A salat, in order to bring it to the fashion and in order to bring it to the image that Allah azza wa jal wants from you, it's going to take years. Hada, we're not speaking about a matter of a day or two, inshallah. Next salat is going to be Allahu Akbar. It's a matter of years. وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, those who put their strive and effort and they put all they have into specific worships, لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Eventually, we'll guide them to the path, to our path. وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah Azza wa Jal concluded in that ayah by calling them from among al-muhsineen, yani excellence, perfection in worship. For this is why, this is how we understand that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the middle of the night would leave his bed, would leave his comfort, would leave his wife to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not a few minutes, not half an hour. Allahu Akbar. And he begins with Surah Al-Baqarah, Ali Imran, Surah Al-Nisa, Al-Ma'idah, Surah Al-An'am, all of this in one rak'ah, all of it. What did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam experience in his salat that motivated him and made him look forward every single night to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and pray? Something incredible that Allah azza wa jal gives ibadallah as-salihin within their heart. And this is it, this is what they look forward towards. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he left all of this to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's ruku' was just as long as he's standing, and his sujood was just as long as he's standing. Yani, how many tasbih? 600? 2,000 tasbih in his ruku'? 1,000, 2,000 tasbih in his sujood? Allahu a'lam how many? But the ruku' was sujood was equal and equivalent to the time he used to take when standing. There is this kind of experience attachment that a person is supposed to have with a salat. Al-Ishmili rahimahullah, when he described the salat, he said, a salat is a mini paradise on earth. It's a mini paradise on earth. Then he explained why he said that. He said, because a salat from the very beginning to the end, it's all about dhikrullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Included in a salat is a tasbih, when you say subhanallah, Subhanallah wa bihamdih. When you say Subhanallah, Subhana Rabbi al-A'la, Subhana Rabbi al-Azim, then as-salat is all about at-takbir, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And it's all about at-tahmid, that you say Rabbana wa laka al-hamdu hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarakan fee. And then he said, in the paradise, these are the only kinds of worship that the people remain upon, which is at-tasbih, at-takbir, wa-tahmid. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that the people of the paradise, yulhamun at-takbir, wa-tahmid, wa-tasbih, that the people of the paradise are given the words of subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wallahu akbar as a subconscious thing they say it. And you sit now and you're breathing. You don't know how many times you breathed in the last minute. Then subconsciously it happens. You don't keep record of it. Something natural that happens. The people of the paradise, dhikrullah is something natural on the tongue. No effort required for it, and it just comes out like this. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, da'wahum fiha, that the people of the paradise, what they say, da'wahum fiha, subhanaka Allahum, wa tahiyyatuhum fiha salam, wa akhiru da'wahum. People in the paradise, they're saying their words, our akhiru da'wahum, and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. The first word that the believers, the first word that mankind said was alhamdulillah, when Allah created Adam alayhi salam, and he sneezed and he said alhamdulillah. And the last word we will say and continuously say in the paradise, wa akhiru da'wahum an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ithan al-Ishbili rahimahullah is trying to describe to us how as-salat is a mini paradise on earth, because it's injected, it's full of dhikr, and the paradise is all dhikr. Therefore, if you do not experience this mini paradise on earth, then you have nothing to look forward towards. For this is why as-salat, my brothers in Islam, we need to understand, is the strong rope, and it is the only connection you're going to have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether in Ramadan or outside of Ramadan. This is why it was called salat. As-salat, it comes from the word silah. Silah means a link and a connection. لأنه nothing is going to connect you to Allah Azza wa Jal in the same manner as-salat would connect you to Allah Azza wa Jal. As-salat has every kind of worship in it. Fasting is found in salat. You're not allowed to eat when you pray. Well, there is qira'atul Qur'an is in as-salat. With dhikr is in as-salat. Patience, it is of as-salat. Nothing tests your patience more than salat. And so when you want to measure your patience, you measure it with how long you spend in your salat. That's how you measure your patience. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبَرُ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Why did he mention as-salat straight after sabr? Because nothing will test your patience like salat. Literally in salat, Allahu Akbar, don't move. Don't scratch if you don't need to scratch. Don't scratch the back of your head if you don't need to do so. Don't adjust your clothes if you don't need to do so. If nothing will test your patience like as-salat. Stand, don't move, focus in front of you. Don't even move left and right, you can't even do that. Don't even look up. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, لَيَنْتَهِيَنَّ أَقْوَامٌ يَرْفَعُونَ أَبْصَارَهُمْ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ أَوْ لَيَخْطِفَنَّ اللَّهُ أَبْصَارَهُمْ. That people that look up in the sky when they pray, they should stop doing so. Otherwise, Allah would blind them, would take their eyesight away. Why? لأنك you're standing before Allah Azza wa Jal. My brothers in Islam, the biggest reason for why khushu' would be brought in a salat is for you to understand that your salat is liqa'un haqiqiyun ma'allah. This is the key of khushu' in salat. This is the key that will enhance and advance your salat. What is it? أن تعلم أن الصلاة لقاء حقيقي مع الله. That you're aware and you acknowledge that as-salat is a real meeting between you and Allah Azza wa Jal. You need to feel this. As-salat is a real meeting before you, between you and Allah Azza wa Jal. The only difference is that you cannot hear him and you cannot see him. That's it. That is the only difference. This is why يعني زكريا عليه السلام, as in the hadith al-sahih, when he gave advice to his people, he gave advice and he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَكُمُ الصَّلَاةِ أَمَرَكُمْ بِالصَّلَاةِ فَإِذَا نَصَبْتُمْ وُجُوهَكُمْ فَلَا تَلْتَفِتُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْصِبُ وَجَهُ لِوَجْهِ عَبْدِهِ حِينَ يُصَلِّي لَهُ. Zakariya alayhi salam, he gave advice to his people. From his advice, this is hadith relevant for all times and places, he said that Allah Azza wa Jal commanded you to pray for him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَكُمْ بِالصَّلَاةِ فَإِذَا نَصَبْتُمْ وُجُوهَكُمْ. As soon as you begin your salat and you're facing Allah in your salat, do not turn left and right. Why? He gave the reason. He said, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْصِبُ وَجْهَهُ لِوَجْهِ عَبْدِهِ حِينَ يُصَلِّي لَهُ. Because Allah is facing the servant when you pray. Allah is facing the servant. فَإِذَا, how rude is it? And how inappropriate is it for a person to look left and right? إذن, هذا secret. This is one of the greatest secrets of attaining khushu' in as-salat, that you recognize and you understand that you're in a real meeting between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Well, this is why al-iqama was recited much quicker than al-adhan. That al-adhan, al-muadhin takes his time. But when the iqama is said, it's recited and it's rushed. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, until we reach qad qamat as-salat. Why was it rushed? لأن by the iqama time, the people are already standing in line. They cannot wait to start. Finish the iqama, yalla, let's start. We're about to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For the iqama is rushed, and the greatest words that are recited and said in al iqama is the word قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ. What does that mean? قَدْ قَامَتِ الصَّلَاةِ. It means the salat has already started. The salat has already been established. So we haven't prayed yet. But the excitement of the person that's giving the adhan, the excitement of the believers, that they want to hear the words, the salat has already started, and they still haven't even said Allahu Akbar yet. Khalas, we're ready, we're on the doors. Finish the iqama, hurry up, and let's start already. You know, subhanAllah, this is the kind of feeling that is supposed to be instilled in a person's heart when he's standing in the lines waiting for a salat. وَالسَّلَفْ رَحِمَهُمُ اللَّهُ وَعِبَادُ اللَّهِ الصَّالِحِينَ in the past. Yani they used to be sad at the end of every salat. لأن the meeting with Allah has ended. And the only thing that would keep them, yani keep hope in them and keep excitement and happiness in them, is the fact that they used to say, yani they would say, I would keep myself patient. The fact that I know in a few hours there's another salat. For he used to keep himself patient because he knows in a few hours there is another salat, another meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These matters are supposed to be taken seriously, my brothers in Islam. Huwa as-salat, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he teaches us that as soon as the servant begins Allahu Akbar, when he says Allahu Akbar, yani the raise, when a person raises his hand to pray, you know, just like if you are arrested, what does a person do? He puts his hand up, he surrenders. And then now you're surrendering to your Creator. Before you begin your salat, you've already known the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and what Allah azza wa jal deserves from you. This hand movement here, it's not just any kind of hand movement. We got no idea where it came from. This, when you raise your hand to your ears or to your shoulders, it's two things. Number one, that as you raise them, into what you're supposed to be acknowledging at this moment is that you've surrendered to the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You've surrendered to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's law and command. And this is one of the forms that you've surrendered for, which is a salat. Allah told you pray at this time. You raised your hand and you said, Allahu Akbar. And you began your salat. The other meaning for it is that as you begin, into this movement here symbolizes that you threw the old life behind you. You threw everything that distracted you, everything that was in front of you, of umur ad-dunya, the matters of this life. You grabbed them all, you picked them up, and you threw them behind your back. And you said, Allahu Akbar, Allah is greater, greater than any distraction in life, greater than my work that would have distracted me from a salat, greater than my wealth, greater than my children, greater than anything that you're doing and you're preoccupied in life. This is the hand movement, Allahu Akbar. And you begin with this word. Allah Azza wa Jal, He chose Allahu Akbar, He chose for it to be the word that is repeated in a salat. How many times is it repeated in one salat? More than 30 times. You know, if you looked at the dhikr, if you looked at al-dhikr, the greatest and the most recurring dhikr on the tongue of mankind is at-takbir, more than anything else. At-takbir in al-salat, how many times do we say it? At-takbir in al-adhan, at-takbir is in al-iqama. After you finish al-salat, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, 33 times. Before you sleep, you're supposed to say Allahu Akbar 33 times, 34 times. At-takbir is everywhere. Yani, pretty much at the end of the day, without you realizing you've said Allahu Akbar more than 300-400 times. Allahu Akbar. When you've said it 400 times in the day, and its meaning hasn't penetrated the heart yet. If it did penetrate the heart, then you're supposed to live Allahu Akbar. Allah is greater than everything. Just to understand the scale of this, you know, until you sit now here in a masjid in Greenacre. You're a person in the masjid in Greenacre. There is some significance for you sitting here. Inna now, let's zoom out. Greenacre, how much space does it take when we're comparing it to Sydney, all of Sydney? Sydney, all of its area, how much is it compared when you compare it to New South Wales itself? New South Wales compared to Australia, what is it? Nothing. The entire world compared to Australia, what is it? The entire universe compared to the earth, what is it? All of this, and keep going until the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, and the seven heavens compared to the kursi of Allah, the footstool of Allah, is just a ring thrown in the desert. Imagine that you went from here to Campbelltown and your wife lost her ring. And we said to everyone, go and find the ring. Who's going to find the ring? The seven heavens compared to the footstool of Allah is like a ring in the desert. This is the meaning of Allahu Akbar. Then the footstool of Allah compared to the arsh of Allah, what is it? It is only a ring that is thrown in the desert. And then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, أُذِنَ لِي أَنْ أُحَدِّثَكُمْ عَنْ مَلَكٍ مِنْ مَلَائِكَةِ اللَّهِ مِنْ حَمَلَةِ الْعَرْشِ. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I was given permission to inform you about one thing, about an angel that carries the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَا بَيْنَ شَحْمَةِ أُذُنَيْهِ إِلَىٰ عَاتِقِهِ مسيرة 700 عام. That the distance between his earlobe and his shoulder is a distance of 700 years. This is who? This is the angel that holds the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's only 8 of them that carry the arsh. We already established that the arsh in comparison to the footstool of Allah is only a ring thrown in the desert. And on top of the arsh is Allah. Hatha the meaning of Allahu Akbar. And you know the beautiful thing of this, that after you experience and you realize what greatness is going on in the paradise and in the heavens, what would you assume is written on top of the arsh? One would assume on top of the arsh, Allah is saying, woe to the one who does disobey me, or woe to the one who doesn't follow my command. That's not written on the arsh. On top of all of this enormous scene, on top of the arsh, Allah wrote, إِنَّ رَحْمَتِي سَبَقَتْ غَضَبِي, that my mercy overrides my anger. My mercy precedes my anger. Subhanallah. Azamatullah, the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For before you pray, before you say Allahu Akbar, you need to experience and realize the greatness of Allah. This is within the word Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is great. My brothers in Islam, had this meaning, it's not just the word Allahu Akbar. When you say Allahu Akbar, realize how huge and how big the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Allah azza wa jalla is the creator. And when Allah azza wa jalla created everything, he created it perfect from first day. From the first time he created the creation, he created it perfect. This is from the meanings of Allahu Akbar. In comparison to what people make, yani 30 years ago, if you looked at cars, you'd laugh. 30 years ago, mankind, every day there's update and there's upgrade in what they manufacture. 50 years ago, the floppy disk, you used to put it inside the computer, 1.44 megabyte. Liam, the card, the USB itself is carrying 8 gig. Mankind is always in update. When Allah Azza wa Jal created the creation from day one, it was perfect. And Allah Azza wa Jal had no assistance, no one helped him to create by himself. And he created everything from nothing, from nothing. That to make something, you're supposed to bring certain material and then put it all together and then you make something. And even then, that's your best shot. 30 years down the track, someone will come and make something better from what you made. And when Allah Azza wa Jal created, he hadn't seen anything before to be inspired from it to create it. Yani when Allah created the sun, he created the sun. No matter everything that the people create now, we created the light after seeing the sun. People made the lamp after they saw the sun. Everything that we make today is inspired by something Allah had already created. The airplane is made on the shape of a bird, which Allah had already created from the beginning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani every day he creates, every day 1,000 birds die and 1,000 birds live. Every day 1,000 plants die and 1,000 plants live. Every day 1,000 sun stars die and 1,000 stars are born. Why? Why every day Allah Azza wa Jalla is creating and causing death upon certain things and creating one thing? So we can see, so we can come to the conclusion of Allahu Akbar. This is the only reason. And still we have people that deny the creation, the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hadali, the one who denies the creation of Allah and the existence of Allah didn't understand anything in life, either. Nothing in life. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَإِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الرَّحْمَانُ الرَّحِيمُ. Allah Azza wa Jal stated a fact in Surah Al-Baqarah that your Lord is one Lord. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ. No Lord but Him. هُوَ الرَّحْمَانُ الرَّحِيمُ. What's the proof? What's the proof that Allah is one Lord? The ayah after it. إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ وَالْفُلْكِ الَّتِي تَجْرِي فِي الْبَحْرِ بما ينفع الناس وما أنزل الله من السماء من رزق فأحيا به الأرض بعد موتها وبث فيها من كل دابة وتصريف الرياح والسحاب المسخر بين السماء والأرض لآيات لقوم يعقلون. إذن one ayah stated that Allah Azza wa Jal is the Lord worthy of worship. He is الرحمن الرحيم. What is the proof? After this, an entire ayah like this, half of a page comes just it came to verify this fact. Allah Azza wa Jal speaks about the creation of the heaven and the earth. That's a sign of His existence and His greatness. the sign of the fact that he has put into this earth many and many of his creation, and the wind and the ship that travels in the oceans, all of this. And when you see it, what you're supposed to conclude is La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. This is the conclusion. Even when you start your salat, Allah Azza wa Jal, in every part of a salat, in every word of a salat, in every movement of a salat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us something to recognize his greatness. For this is how you're going to begin to experience your salat and allow your salat to cause a change in your life. Where's the effect of a salat in our life? You see, my brothers in Islam, everything that happens in your day and your night, you see the effect of it on you. If a person gets married, you see happiness and excitement on his face. If a person earns his check at the end of the week, you see excitement on his face and in his actions. If a person was to, given an upgrade in his job or whatever it is, or a pay rise, you'll see it in him. Yani everything you do in life, its effect is seen on you. Tayyib, as-salat, where's its effect? Allah Azza wa Jal, when he described the companions, he said, سِيمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ. That light and brightness and contentment and tranquility and peace can be seen of their face as a result of their sujood. The sujood, what has it done in your life? What change has a sujood brought about in your life? This is a sujood, let alone a salat itself, it's supposed to bring a huge change on a person. A salat is a tool that changes a person. Allah Azza wa Jal, he said, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةِ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. A salat is supposed to stop you from al-haram. مَنَ الْفَحْشَاءِ. Al-fahsha is the major sins. Al-munkar are the sins that a person is supposed to keep away from. Like looking at women, speaking to women, whatever it is of the sins of al-munkar that Allah Azza wa Jal dislikes for his servant to engage in. One salat is enough to change all of this. My brothers in Islam, yani some people became min ibadillahi as-salihin because of one search that they did. Some people became min ibadillahi as-salihin and earned the highest level in the paradise because of ihdina as-salat al-mustaqim, once he recited it. That's the reality. That's a salat. The first reason for why people enter the paradise is because of their khushu' in as-salat. Allah Azza wa Jal, he says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Then he lists qualities. The first one, he said, الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Those who had khushu' in their salat, deep focus and concentration. At the end of the passage, الَّذِينَ يَرِثُونَ الْفِرْدَوْسِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. The word firdaus only came twice in the Quran. This was one of them. Half the road to paradise was your khushu' in salat. This is what a salat did to people. It changed their life. Allah Azza wa Jal says, min athar as-sujood. As-sujood is supposed to have an athar. Yani as-sujood is supposed to have an effect. It's supposed to have a long-lasting effect on a person. As-salat, what effect has it had in our life? When a person prays and after his salat he's back into his routine of sin and disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yani we're not saying that the salat was useless. Keep trying, keep going. You're going to fall and you're going to get back up. Nama, the loser is the one who gives up altogether. Your salat, you're not seeing its effect. Ask Allah to give you the taste of a salat. Ask Allah to give you al khushu' in a salat. That was our last lesson. Seek Allah's help in matters of worship, and worship and don't give up. That's why iyyaka na'bud came before iyyaka nasta'in. Na'bud is the action part. Nasta'in is seeking Allah's help. Yani begin the ibadah, begin the worship, then ask Allah Azza wa Jal for help. Don't give up. It's not the other way around. فَإِذَنْ يعني, we need to understand, where is the effect of a salat? Where is the effect of a sujood? There was a sheikh in Zaman, rahimahullah, he died now. But he used to cure the people. He used to prescribe for them sujood. And that would cure them from their problems. He was like a doctor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The patient would come to him and say, Wallah, I have back problems. And you need sujood for half an hour. And don't come again. Go and drop into sujood for half an hour. Half an hour sujood, he was cured by the permission of Allah. Someone would come with a problem and go make sujood for an hour. Salli two rak'at in the middle of the night and stay in your sujood 2 hours, beg Allah. He used to cure the people with prescribing to them sujood. لأن السجود is the closest point you are to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you haven't taken this position serious in your life, and if you do not request from Allah and ask Allah in that position, how's it going to make sense to you to ask Him any other time? Allah Azza wa Jal, open the door of salat, pray anytime you want. Just after al-fajr until the sun rises, and after asr until maghrib. Well, salat al-istikhara is excluded from this rule. Salat al-istikhara, when one wants to pray and ask Allah for something to help him in a matter in life, you know salat al-istikhara. That can be prayed anytime. There is no time that forbids you to pray salat al-istikhara in. Even if it was after. The prayer now is impermissible. It's not allowed to pray now. Now, if you have an urgent case right now, something happened, you need to seek Allah's advice on this matter. You need to ask Allah for the goodness of this matter. You're allowed to pray salat al-istikhara right now, no problems. After salat al-asr, at least you can pray. The door of salat is always open. Well, the greatest thing you can do in a salat is a dua in your sujood. The greatest point and position you are to Allah Azza wa Jal. When they still haven't taken advantage of this, you need to understand the salat is a revolutionary worship. Allah Azza wa Jal gave it to us, and it began from day one. No prophet and no nation before us was ever deprived from the understanding or the worship of a salat. Allah Azza wa Jal, He says in Surah Al-Bayyinah, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهِ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاءَ وَيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُوا الزَّكَاةَ وَذَلِكَ دِينُ الْقَيِّمَةِ. This ayah in Surah Al-Bayyinah mentions five things. These five things are things that were legislated on every single nation from Adam alayhi salam's time until the end of time. And within this ayah was, وَيُقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ. Every nation had salah. But the only difference is that perhaps their salat was different to our salat. The way they prayed, like for example, in Isa alayhi salam's time, in the Mosaic law, Musa alayhi salam's time, a sujood came before the ruku'ah. People would go down into sujood, then to in ruku'ah. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Ya Maryam, usjudi li rabbiki warka'i. Usjudi first, then arka'i. A sujood came before ruku'ah. Nama today, al ruku'ah comes before the sujood. No problems. But at the end of the day, this entire worship of salat was legislated for everyone. Then, the first step and the first road in attaining this tranquility wal khushu' in as-salat that would change your life completely is that you recognize the greatness of Allah, and that you recognize as-salat is a true meeting between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that when you begin and you say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, that Allah Azza wa Jal Himself responds and He says Hamidani Abdi, my servant has praised me. That do you feel this response as you're praying? We're supposed to feel this. This is why some of the Salaf, when they used to begin their Salat and read Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, he would stop, he would pause. Then say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, then pause. Then when he was asked, why is this pause between the ayat? He said, Lainni, I feel Allah's response. I try to hear Allah Azza wa Jal's response. When you say Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah says Hamidani Abdi, my servant has praised me. You say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Allah says Athna Alayya Abdi, my servant has overpraised me. You say Maliki Yawm Ad-Din, Allah says Majjadani Abdi, my servant has glorified me. Three ayat only, Allah has said Abdi, Abdi, Abdi three times. You enter the word Abdi with all your sins and all your disobedience and all your heedlessness and all your ignorance of Allah. Allah is calling you in the first moments of a salat, Abdi, Abdi, Abdi. It's the greatness of a salat. That when you experience this, wallahi, a person is shy to even look left and right. This is why you're not supposed to look left and right. Then no, aren't you embarrassed that Allah has called you already in a few seconds, Abdi three times? Where's the idea of moving left and right and scratching your head and adjusting your clothes? Where's the idea of this going to come when you're thinking like this and this is what's happening in a salat? And then you continue your salat. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. When you say Iyyaka na'bud, you alone we worship. And then connect this ayah to your standing. That this standing is the ibadah that you're saying Iyyaka na'bud to. This is it. Don't detach this ayah from your salat. Yani your salat is the greatest proof of you declaring إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ as you pray. And then you say, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, you alone we seek your help. You declared that. You said that you only seek Allah's help. They prove it. The ayah after it, اِهْدِنَا الصَّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ, guide us to the straight path. Huh? You see how you proved? You just a second ago, you said, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, we are not going to seek help through anyone but you. And then you prove it by making that dua, seeking Allah's help. اِهْدِنَا, اِهْدِنَا الصَّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ, guide us to the straight path. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم, not to any kind of path. Give us a salat of the prophets. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم, أنعمت عليهم are the prophets, are the righteous, are the truthful ones, are the companions. فأنت أنت in your when you're saying اهدنا الصراط, you're not just يعني you're not settled with anything. As you're in a salat, you know that this is the greatest position you're going to stand before Allah. And if you're going to ask and request, request big. You're asking Allah to give you the guidance of prophets. Give me what the prophets have of guidance. Give me what the righteous and the companions had of guidance. Give me that. That's what I want. That's an appropriate dua when you're standing in salat. You're standing before Allah Azza wa Jal. The one who, if he was to give everyone, nothing would increase from his kingdom. Nothing would decrease from his kingdom. That's who you're asking. This is what as-salat is. Fanta, you need to feel these conscience. You need to be conscious of these meanings as you're praying your salat. You know, when you pray, in as-salat, when the imam's voice is good, you say, that helps me in khushu'ah. It helps me in khushu'ah. If the imam, his sound is beautiful, mashallah, I can pray the whole night under, behind him. Khinta, we just said, as-salat is a meeting between you and Allah Azza wa Jal. There will come a day in which we will hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If the sound of the imam, if the voice of the imam motivated you to pray the entire night behind him because of his voice, imagine then when you hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. Salamun qawlan qawlan min rabbir rahim. Allah speaks to his servants. And this is when we die, when eventually we're all gone and dead. Angels, they come. You know what they do? They come with kafan min akfan al-jannah wa hanutun min hanut al-jannah. When the angels, they come to a person, when they present themselves to a person as he's dying, they take his soul. The soul's out now. They shroud it with the shrouding of the paradise. Yani you're dressed with garments of the paradise. And it's perfumed with perfume of the paradise. Why? This soul now is going to meet Allah. It's not appropriate for it to go with these clothes. These are prison clothes. الدنيا سجن المؤمن. The worldly life is a prison. These are prison clothes. You can't meet Allah with this. For they dress you from the dressing of the paradise. Perfume from the perfume of the paradise. And the soul goes straight up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if Allah is pleased with that soul, it'll hear Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah would say, أَنْ صَدَقَ عَبْدِي فَاكْتُبُوا كِتَابَ عَبْدِي فِي عِلِّيِّينَ. My servant has been truthful with me. My servant has been honest with me. صَدَقَ عَبْدِي. But if Allah is pleased with you, will you hear it? اكْتُبُوا كِتَابَ عَبْدِي فِي عِلِّيِّينَ. Record and register and leave the book of good deeds. Leave it in Iliyin, leave it here. With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is your title deed to your property in the paradise. You know, with any title deed in life, where is it? You don't keep it hanging anywhere. You either put it with a lawyer, you put it in a safe, you lock on it. One document could be that expensive. Anta kitab al-abd, your book, your record, hada your title deed to your property in the paradise. If Allah reserves it and keeps it with him. And then your soul is sent back down and into the grave, into your body. And this is why now the believer, what does he say? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to us that the believer from then, he would say, Rabbi aqim al-sa'a, Rabbi aqim al-sa'a. Hurry up my Lord, hasten the hour, bring it. Yalla, khalas. We want, this is the meaning of Allah. There's supposed to be a rush. There's supposed to be an excitement. That when you pray behind the imam, sah, maybe the sound, the voice of the imam gives you encouragement and motivation. But then as you pray, As-salat, it's all about spiritual meanings. Think of hearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. Think of the day that you'll stand before Allah and Allah would speak to you. And then that in itself should be enough to keep you praying. And to develop this khushu' in your salat, that should be enough. يعني, the problem is we've detached our salat from these spiritual meanings. This is the problem. As-salat now has only become a matter of physical worship. Just Allahu Akbar. As-salat is not about physical worship. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla has given concession to the sick to pray sitting. The one who can't pray sitting can pray lying down. The one who can't move his hands can just move his eyes. As-salat wasn't about physical movement. For the one who can physically move, that's your shukr to Allah that you move properly and you do the prayers as they're supposed to be. But as-salat in its core meaning was about its spiritual meanings. That's what you're supposed to live with. The more you learn about as-salat, the positions of as-salat, the words that are said in salat, the more and more khushu' is developed. This is why, yani, inshallah, this is yani, a kind of program that yani, I'm putting together so we can share, inshallah ta'ala, so that we work towards a better prayer. The more you understand what you're saying, the more you understand the movements and positions of salat, the more khushu' will be injected in the salat of yours. This is what we need to understand. And one more matter, and I conclude with this, and this is the hadith of Uthman ibn Abi al-Aas, radiyallahu anhu. Uthman ibn Abi al-Aas, we're concluding with this. It's a story, yani. Uthman ibn Abi al-Aas, radiyallahu anhu, a companion. And this story is going to tell us another thing that will add khushu' in our salat. A companion, he accepted Islam when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appointed him as an amir upon the people of Al-Ta'if. There are people living on Al-Ta'if. He appointed him amir. Go there, pray there, give them da'wah, teach them. Fa'Uthman ibn Abi al-Aas, he's an imam in Al-Ta'if, far away from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For he says, and this is a hadith in Sahih Muslim, he says, إن الشيطان قد حال بيني وبين صلاتي وقراءتي يلبسها علي. He said, الشيطان came to me in my salat and he is starting to distract me in my salat. Uthman ibn Abi al-Aas is experiencing distraction in salat. Doesn't know what he's reading. He forgets some ayat. He prayed three rak'at. I don't know, did I pray three or two or four rak'at? Did I pray one rak'ah or two rak'at? He doesn't know what he's praying. This affects all of us. Then Uthman radiallahu anhu, Uthman ibn Abi al-Aas is a good example for all of us. Good story. So, you know what he did? He traveled to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, Shaytan has distracted me. He stood as a barrier between me and my salat and he's just confusing me in my salat. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to him, ذَاكَ شَيْطَانٌ يُقَالُ لَهُ خِنْزَبْ. He said, that distraction comes from a salat, from a shaytan, his name is Khinsab. فَإِذَا جَاءَكْ, if he comes to try to distract you, spittle to your left three times. Like that, spittle to your left three times. وَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. And say, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. Uthman ibn Abi al-Aas, he took this remedy. He went back to Al-Ta'if. He said, I did that, فَأَذْهَبَهُ اللَّهُ عَنِّي, and Allah took this shaytan away. But in analysis of this hadith, look, Uthman ibn Abi al-Aas, he was experiencing what most people today experience and perhaps suffer from. Al-waswas bil-salat, I can't concentrate in salat. Like, what did he do about it? He didn't just ignore the problem and move on. He jumped on his camel, took a 6-day journey until he reached Al-Madinah. Between Al-Ta'if and Medina is 500 kilometers on his camel alone to address this issue. Yani, how much was he in contact and connection with the salat? That if his salat just, he felt a little problem. Allahu Akbar, this is a big problem. Yani, most of us said, Ya Allah, when was the last question you ever asked? How do I increase my khushu' in salat? People don't care about this anymore. للأسف, للأسف, people don't care. Salah, salli, he prayed on time, he didn't pray on time, I missed it, I didn't miss it, move on. Life goes on, brother, what am I going to do? Uthman ibn Abi al-Aas, radiallahu anhu, can't settle even though he's praying. He took a journey of 5 days just to get to Rasulullah. And who better than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to answer the question? Ya Rasulullah, I need help. My khushu' in salah is lacking. I'm forgetting, I'm confused in my salah, give me something. He addressed his blood, that was his concern. What's your concern? What kind of concern and to what extent have you done to address your problem? Yani, this is, imagine, this is like something, you know, you can't concentrate. So you went and booked a hotel in Saudi and you booked a ticket and you went there to a scholar and you sat with him and you said to him, Ya Sheikh, and I can't concentrate in my salah, give me a solution. He gives you a solution and you jump back on the plane and you'll be here in less than 5 days, you'll be here if you did that. Uthman ibn Amr, 10 days to go and come back. And then the solution was in what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him. And we'll conclude with this. He said to him, ذَاكَ شَيْطَانٌ يُقَالُ لَهُ خِنْزَبْ. He said to him, this is a shaytan that comes to you. His name is Khinzab. Now, why is it important? Why is it important for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say it's a shaytan? This is the importance. That this shaytan is a special shaytan. His name is Khinzab. He only comes when you say Allahu Akbar. And he disappears when you say Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. He's gone, finished. He comes. He reminds you of things you forgot about. He reminds you what you're supposed to do in the next hour. He reminds you of something you left in the car. He tells you this, and then this is what he does. He distracts. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to Uthman ibn Abi al-'Aas, ذَاكَ شَيْطَان. It's a shaytan. Why did he tell him this? لَأَنُّ when you begin your salat, and you realize that there is an enemy that's going to come and fight you in your salat, you'll be more careful and you'll concentrate more. Then if you were to begin your salat and not realize there's an enemy standing in your path. Yani, I'll give you an example. If I tell you, brother, go down to the coffee shop and get us a cup of coffee and come back. Normal, easy. Take your shoes, you go down, you buy a cup of coffee, you come back. But if I said to you, brother, go and get that cup of coffee, but beware. I don't know who's on the road. There's robbers, there's thieves, there's criminals, I don't know, be careful, huh? Be careful. Now, your attitude when you go down to that cafe is not going to be like your attitude when there's no danger and threat on the road. When you know there's threat on the road, your eyes are opened. You might carry something with you. You're looking left and right to make sure that no one harms you. The only difference is that when you begin your salat and you say, Allahu Akbar, if you begin with this lazy attitude, like there's no threat and no harm, Allahu Akbar, well, that's when he comes and he takes you. Well, shaytan is not going to steal money from your pocket. He's going to steal your salat. That's why in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says some people pray and after their salat, they receive only half the reward of a salat. Some leave their salat, they take only a quarter of their salat reward. Some take a sixth. Some take an eighth. Hadha al-hadith. And then worse than that, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, some leave the salah and take no reward. Zero. Shaytan stole it all. La, la'annu anta, you started thinking there's nothing in front of you. That's why where the imam prays, you know, what's it called? Where the imam prays inside of, what's it called? It's mentioned in the Quran, huh? Al-mihrab. Kullama dakhala alayha Zakariya al-mihrab. Why was it called the mihrab? It comes from the word harb. Then there's a battle between you and the shaytan. If you don't recognize and realize this, your salat is going to go. The reward of a salat is going to go. إِذَا ذَاكَ الشَّيْطَانِ يُقَالُ لَهُ خِنْزَبْ. How can Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is telling Uthman ibn Abi al-'Aas, be careful. When you Allahu Akbar, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله, and you start reading. Shaytan on the road. He wants to steal your salah. He wants to steal your distraction. Be careful, be alert. Allah Azza wa Jal gave us every reason to be careful and alert in a salat. Enough to recognize that you're standing before Allah Azza wa Jal. Khalas, understand these meanings, brother. Understand these meanings. You're going into ruku' and going up and into sujood. Every single position is bringing you closer and closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. Shaytan wants to steal it. For then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said to him, if you experience him again, yani, what that means is, if you experience, you doze off, you become heedless in your salah, you forget something, you remember something that's got nothing to do with salah, right then and there, spittle three times to your left, immediately, wherever you are, whether you're in ruku' and sujood, standing, wherever position you are, in immediate, this is your ammunition against him. And then say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim in yourself. Keep doing it. Eventually it's like until you stoned him until he dies and he disappears from your salat altogether. So these are reasons. We mentioned one of the reasons was to recognize the greatness of Allah, was to recognize that you're in a real meeting between you and Allah Azza wa Jal, was to recognize that you are actually talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then to realize that there's an enemy on the road and you need to be careful of him. So when you begin your salat, begin with the attitude of a person that knows there is danger and harm on his road. If these matters are done, inshallah, we'll add to them some more later on, but if these essential primary matters are done, it'll take the salat to another level, completely to another level. وبالاجتهاد and work hard وأسك الله عز وجل والتوبة والgoodness and be alive and alert and heedless of Allah عز وجل, be conscious of Allah عز وجل during the day, during the night. بإذن الله إن شاء الله الله عز وجل gives you that which you're aspiring for. وأسك الله سبحانه وتعالى to give us this خشوع in our salat. وأسك him سبحانه وتعالى to make us people of the paradise, people of الفردوس الأعلى من الجنة. إنه ولي ذلك وقادر عليه. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.